Hi, I'm Kelly, and I'm uncovering the origins of our food, one destination at a time. On this week's episode, Veronica schools me on the origin of Southern food.
Come here.
Yeah, come here.
What's come here?
Come here is a person who has come here.
And there's a come back here.
Come back here. Plenty come back here.
Every goodbye ain't gone.
Plus, we master the perfect fish fry and learn how to stretch a weak catch.
Got a little mustard, mayonnaise, some panko breadcrumbs.
All within the mini golf capital of the world, Myrtle Beach. This is Original Fare. In Conway, South Carolina, I meet up with Veronica and Jesse, authors of the Gullah Cookbook and owners of the Ultimate Gullah Store.
We thought Gullah food culture needed to be introduced into the conversation. That's why we wrote the book. And Jesse wanted to find a way to put love in a bottle, and that's why he created the Gullah Love.
We have a trademark of Gullah Love and Hot Love as well. You can always come to the shop or order online, get your love and get your hot love.
You get hot love online.
I think I've heard of that.
Yeah, hot love.
Gullah Geechee refers to descendants of African people who were enslaved in the South and the language, food, and culture they still maintain today.
Everybody talks about Lowcountry cuisine,
yes.
Lowcountry seafood.
It's not rocket scientists as to who was in the kitchen. A lot of the people who owned slaves were not very rich, so they were trying to make ends meet too. So a lot of times the slaves brought making ends meet to the table.
Jesse, a former restaurant owner, takes me through the traditional fish fry.
I brought three types of fish, and all three of them are considered a poor man's fish because you don't need a rod and reel. This is croaker here. This right here is perch. And this is spot. Now, in Conway, walk on my neck, spot is the most popular fish. And they cook it with the head on.
When I went to college and fried fish with the head on, it was my college friends who laughed at me and thought that something
really?
Was wrong. That's when I knew something was different about it. So, but anyway, the head, they do a hard crisp, a hard fry, so that the head is kind of crunchy. And the other people would eat the whole thing, eyes and all.
We crack eggs to create an egg wash. That takes some practice.
Yeah.
You put the seasoning, which is Gullah Love, into the batter. You want to make sure that you let the excess egg drain off of it, then cover it and shake off the excess. Now, if need be, you can always take it back to the egg wash, which will put a crunchier exterior.
You introduced this recipe then to Jesse.
My grandmother, Lula, she fished. If she didn't bring home any fish, you didn't get to eat. So we put it in the cookbook, Lula's Fried Fish. So this recipe is special.
That's you want to grab it by the tail, and you want to lower it into the oil. Because if you drop it, it's going to splash on you. Fish is going to take probably about 4 minutes to cook. And the way that you tell that fish is done is it'll float to the top and you won't see all those bubbles. Right, what's happening is the water and the oil is fighting in there. And once it calms down, that means the oil has won.
Yeah.
And the fish is done. So we're gonna look at the fish and see whether or not it's done. It's golden brown and it's ready to come out of here.
Generally, I would not give up the head, but for you,
really?
You have the head.
You are too kind.
When you're little, they cut off and give you the tail because that's the safest part.
This was so simple to do. It's so
it was.
Delicious.
Yeah.
Hey.
In nearby Merle's Inlet, I meet up with avid outdoorsman Chad and fisherman Jason.
Thank you guys so much for taking us out this morning.
Yeah, thank you, Jason.
Hey. This is what you want. You want a little wave, a little bit of wind. Main thing with this is you want to stay off of them. You don't want to spook them. You kind of want to drift everything to them, not necessarily cast to them.
I'm cold.
Nice.
Hook him right through his little thing. It's like his fingernail. Kind of swing it out there. What you want to do is just leave your bail open.
Okay.
Kind of just let it kind of freely drift. Hopefully the wind and current will push it in towards those rocks.
Okay.
But you just simply drift it. What happens when the cork goes under, you just simply flip your bail and then reel until you actually feel something pulling, and then you actually set the hook and reel it.
Yeah, believe it is. Yeah, it is. That's a fish.
Fighting
now.
Come on, we need lunch.
Hey. Hey,
that's a good time, man. Hey. Gotta start
somewhere. It's probably gonna be a game. Flounder! Might be able to eat lunch after all.
Oh my.
Got one! It's been a long morning.
Back at the dock, Jason shows me how to clean the flounder.
Probably the most sought after game fish in Myrtle's Inlet because of the table. Cut right behind the fin, split them in half. They got a raised backbone, which is right in the middle. You're gonna remove the fillet, going bone to skin. This right here is the rib cage. You wanna take the skin off. You just simply hold the skin at the back, angle your knife. They got another little set of bones right here. You just simply remove those by pulling the front one. Boneless, skinless fillet, just like in the grocery store.
Chef Nick at Wicked Tuna said he'd prepare whatever we caught, but one little flounder for three hungry people?
So we're gonna stuff some with a blue crab and roast it off, and some nice sauteed asparagus from our farmer's market, and a little risotto to go with it. I guess I'll start rolling up the flounder. I'm gonna take the larger fillets, take some of our nice Lowcountry crab cake mix.
And what do you put in your crab cake mix?
It's got a little mustard, mayonnaise, some panko breadcrumbs, fresh herbs. Really basically it. You just want to enhance the taste of the crab, not really overpower it with anything.
You put a little water in that pan and now butter. Is that just to help?
Water and lemon
juice. Mm-hmm.
All right, I want the flavor from the lemon juice and the butter, but I want to put a little bit of water in there too to make sure that it doesn't dry out. If it dries out and scorches, you're going to get a bad taste. All right, so now we're going to put it in the oven.
And how long is that going to stay in there?
Maybe 5 minutes. I'm going to make sure the crab inside is as hot as the fish without it drying out and overcooking as well. So high heat, less time.
Got it.
Let's check our fish out.
You want to see it pretty white throughout?
White throughout. Flesh needs to be firm. As firm as cooked. All right, let's plate this stuff up. This is a nice little red pepper sauce we got here.
Beautiful.
A nice mushroom risotto. Our crab stuffed flounder. And a little eye appeal. Here's your Myrtle's Inlet treat.
Beautiful. All right, guys, I'm gonna feed you first.
Oh, God.
Okay. Crab stuffed flounder with some mushroom risotto.
It's good, man.
All that hard work, catch that little flounder.
You did, like, so good.
We recommend getting a good night's rest on the beach at Island Vista. Not only are the nicest folks cooking in Cypress Room, but Chef Mike's take on bouillabaisse using the local fare is sure to please. Next time on Original Fare, we learn a tasty how-to from Chef Banta at the Kiowa Resort.